Welcome friends, we are back here in Alpha 18 for 7 Days to Die. If you've had a good chance to play Alpha 18, you probably have been playing single player, or maybe you've had the chance to play with friends on a server. And there are different ways of setting up a server. You can run it just in the client, which works sort of. You can set up a dedicated on your own, or you can run a hosted one. This time I am going to show you how do you install Alpha 18 Experimental on a dedicated local server on your PC. If you're looking for hosted solution, I'm going to be leaving a link in the description to another video where I've shown how to set that up. And this is with the PingPerfect, and they do have a 48-hour trial, so you can always try it out. If you like it, continue. If not, then just cancel it. But this time I will be in Steam, and I will be installing it from Steam as well. I'm not going to be using Steam command. I'm going to go through the client because it's the easiest way. So the UI is slightly different than previously. So you have to go to games, and you have to select tools, and I'm going to do this one so I only show my servers and everything. And you'll see you'll have a 7 Days to Die dedicated server. Now don't click install just yet because it will install the old version or the stable version. You want to go to properties, and once you're here, you go to betas and you scroll all the way down to latest experimental build. If you want to have a different version, obviously you can do that. If you select just none, it'll give you the alpha 17.4 stable because that's the latest stable. We want the experimental, the alpha 18 experimental. You hit OK and install. It will tell you where it's going to install everything, and I'm going to say yep, go ahead. And it will take some time as it just allocates the space and then downloads it. And while I and you are waiting to download it, take a moment, just give me that subscribe on my channel because it really helps out for a small channel like mine. And why not just join me on Twitter as well? I follow back gamers and join my Discord. Come hang out and discuss the game. And if this guide was really useful, why not buy me a coffee by supporting me on Patreon? It helps me provide this content for all of you. And finally it's done and you just hit launch. No, stop. Don't hit launch. This is not a game client. This is a server. It needs to be configured. So right click, properties, you go to local files and browse local files. Important. That brings you to the server location on your PC and the hard drive or SSD. The important file that you want to look at is this serverconfig.xml. So you want to configure that one. So you open it up in your editor and you'll see all these weird different properties that you need to take a look at. All of them is not equally important. I'm going to go through some of them, not all of them, but they do have fairly good descriptions on the right side, in this case in green, so it's easy to read. Server name and server description, you decide that yourself. Same with the server website URL. Server password, if you don't want people to be able to just log into it, put something there, I always do that. Server login confirmation text can be useful because it means that when people join the server, right before they enter it, there'll be a box that they then have to confirm or leave so that you don't just spawn in immediately. Port and visibility can be important. Port depends on what you want to have it running on. And this one also relates to your port forwarding on your router. So take note of this one. Server disable protocols. Standard, it disables Steam networking. It's been an issue in the past. So if this one works while it's disabled, just leave it. Otherwise, try removing it if there is some networking problems. You can specify the server max player count. Reserve slots, and there's some other in here. I'm not going to go through control panel. That's if you want to have a web page access to your server, normally not needed. Telnet, you probably can leave this on, but make sure you put a password on it so people don't just log into it. If you're running this on a standard PC, it can be useful to just have the terminal window enabled because it will pop up a window to allow you to check what's happening with the servers. I'm going to show that after I start it up. ESC enabled is the easy anti-cheat. On or off, depends if you're playing with friends, you can just turn to false. Some mod packs require it to be false. Generally true doesn't hurt. Persistent player profiles, I tend to turn that as true. It basically means that they'll have the same profile regardless if they change their player in the client. Now, here to some of the more pertinent items. Game world, Navis gain or random world generation. Important, you have to consider that. A new thing for Alpha 18 is that there seems to be a pre-gen Seer 1 world that you can also choose. So this is a pre-generated one in case you're having issues generating your own random world. The seed is, well, if you're generating a random world, this one will matter. The size of it also matter. The bigger causes more memory and takes longer to generate. Game name is the whatever the name you want to have. It also affects the save game name in the folders. It helps to keep track of the world in the folder structure. We have the game difficulty, 2 is the average. If you do 3, it's slightly harder. If you do 1, it's easier. Some of these is basically, you can read what they say, but block damage to player, damage to AI, Blood Moon Horde. You can turn on creative, true or false. The length of the day, do you want a 60 minutes, 90, 120? How many hours? Does the night come at 2200 hour, or does it come earlier? If you have a really good PC, you could increase the max spawn zombies, for instance, or the max spawn animals. It will impact the game performance if your hardware cannot handle it. You have some of the zombie settings that it can be important to do as well. Interesting in the latest versions is that you can change how often the Blood Moon comes. It's standard every 7 days. You can change it to 1, you can change it to 10 or 100 if you want to. And also if this has a range, meaning if it's plus minus 1, plus minus 2, plus minus 5, to randomize it. Blood Moon enemy count is number of zombies spawned during Blood Moon per player, max. It doesn't necessarily mean it's going to be up to 8. Take care if you're increasing this, if you're having a lot of players on your server, because let's say you have 5 players, that means 8 times 5 is 40. If you have 10 players, it's 80. And if you increase this to say 16, you can imagine you're going to have 160 servers, which obviously is going to hit this limit as well. And you might have performance issues. Another interesting thing is the party shared kill range. 100 meters is the default. I tend to increase this to 500 just to make it a little bit easier for parties to sort of group together and gain experience. Player killing mode, well, do you want to be able to kill everyone? I tend to do, again, just kill strangers only, just to keep it manageable so you don't accidentally shoot your friend in the back when you're exploring or bash him with your sledgehammer. So that's it. I'm done, and I'm going to just launch it. You'll see, file not found, because you're starting to find the log files. Alright, it'll take a while, and then you should say game server init successful. That means it should be done. And this is the terminal window that we saw in the setting. You can do help, and you'll have all the different variables or commands that you can access through this command one. And if this one comes up, generally it means the game is running. So what do you do if this one doesn't come out, or you have a lot of errors? Good question. But let's do a shutdown and look at that. Always make sure that you shut down the server through the terminal, or possibly in the client if you have admin powers enabled, because otherwise if you just kill it, you might have corruption and you don't want that. So we're done. Now we're going to look at the logs, and we're going to go back here, and we're going to go to the 7 days to die server data, and you'll see output log. We're going to open that up. And this covers everything that is happening in the server as it starts up. And if we go down to the bottom, you'll see it did the garbage collector, it shut everything down, I was fine. Usually what will happen, let me see if I can find the started place. Right, this is where it says it's successfully started. If there are issues, you will have errors up here, usually right towards the end, where it will tell you some information about what's happened. And that can help you track things down. Now, it can be a bit tricky depending on what it is, but generally, if the server doesn't start up, look here. That's the first thing to look, because at least it will give you some information of what could be the problem. So a common issue that people have with 7 Days to Die when they're running a dedicated server is that people say that, oh, no one can log in from outside my network. And that's because you probably do not have port forwarding open on your firewall or your router. Really important. Now, the important ones, and it does mention, you know, some extra ones if you're doing administration remotely, 8082 for web, for the web map if you use an Alex Fixes, but you don't worry about that right now. TCP, you have to open 26900. UDP, 26900 to 26902. And again, you saw that in the server config .xml that we could specify which port. So if you change it, make sure you change the port forwarding as well. And how do you do that? It's really dependent on your brand of router. It's not so easy. I will leave a link to this 7days.io dedicated server that is up on the Valve, the Steam developer website, which has a link to some port forwarding instructions for various brands. So common one is D-Link, and that's one I've been using in the past as well. And the guide will tell you how to actually get to here and what to put in. But basically, you put in the port, though, the port range, the traffic type TCP or UDP, and what your local PC is, so it knows where to forward it. And it also has this information here. So do follow that guide if you're having issues. And again, each router handles this separately, but if you're having issues where you on the local PC can connect to the server, but no one from outside of your network can connect, usually it is because the port forwarding is not working properly, and this is a good resource to look at it. And if you really can't get this to work on your dedicated, well, you can always consider a hosted solution. It does mean you have to pay a little bit for it, but you avoid all these issues with the router forwarding. And of course, it means that you don't have to keep your PC running all the time as well for your friends to play the game. And if that's the case, have a look at my description below. I will leave a link because it does come with a 10% voucher and it is an affiliate link, so it does help to support my channel. But hope you enjoy and hope you get this up and running and enjoy the game with your friends. I'll catch you again.
Special thanks to the great patrons supporting the channel. If you would like to join the Vedit community and support these videos, do follow the Patreon link.